The purpose of a pesticide application is to control a pest population. Ideally, pesticide application should impact only the target organism and have little or no impact on other organisms in the environment. However, many pesticide applications have the potential to affect non-target organisms and move beyond the application site. Pesticide residues get into the environment as a result of an application or by accident and may be found in the air, water, or soil. The potential for a pesticide to contaminate the environment depends in large part on the nature of the pesticide, its ability to break down in a given substrate, type of formulation, application rate, frequency of application, and environmental conditions. I'm Dr. DeBusque, and in this video, I'm going to talk about the different environmental concerns with pesticide use. Pesticides become airborne in many ways, including volatilization, drift, or through movement as dust-borne particles. The process by which a pesticide changes from a liquid to a vapor is called volatilization. Volatilized pesticides leave the application site and move into the atmosphere, often traveling long distances. Compounds that vaporize or evaporate at low temperatures are said to be highly volatile. Volatility is a useful property that helps disperse a pesticide in the target area and increase exposure of pests to the pesticide, but it also can lead to exposure for non-target organisms. Environmental conditions such as air movement, relative humidity, and temperature also influence volatilization. A number of pesticides, such as emulsifiable concentrate formulations and all the fumigants, are considered as volatile organic compounds, VOCs, because they readily volatilize in the atmosphere. In the presence of sunlight, VOCs react with nitrogen oxides to produce ozone, which can contribute to smog, respiratory irritation, and plant injury. Practices that restrict movement of an applied pesticide, such as soil incorporation, tarping, or applying pesticides at night when there is less heat and wind and often higher humidity, reduce volatilization. Drift refers to the airborne movement of pesticides away from the treatment site during application. Drift can damage plants away from the application site, reduce effectiveness to a pesticide application, and cause environmental contamination such as water pollution. Drift is most serious when applications are made in windy conditions. Low relative humidity and high temperatures increase the potential for drift by causing spray droplets to evaporate faster. Air temperature also contributes to pesticide drift by creating inversion layers, where a layer of cool air near the soil surface is trapped under a layer of warmer air. During a pesticide application, inversion layers will cause fine spray droplets and pesticide vapors to become trapped, forming a concentrated cloud that can move from the treatment site. Droplet size is another important factor in the movement of spray particles away from the application site. Small droplets fall through the air slowly and have a greater potential to drift. Large droplets fall faster and are more likely to fall to the ground. Applications that release the pesticide as close to the target site as possible reduce drift. Spray pressure also affects drift by influencing the size of spray droplets. Higher pressure decreases droplet size and increases drift. Precautionary practices include avoiding spraying when wind speed is high, above 10 miles per hour, or blowing towards sensitive or non-target crops, dwellings, livestock, or water sources. Use buffer zones to increase the distance that spray droplets have to move to reach non-target areas. Use adjuvants to increase spray droplet size when possible. Pesticides move around in the air on dust particles in several ways. Fine particles of pesticide dust formulations may be moved in the air during the application process. Liquid pesticide droplets may also adhere to soil particles after application and later be carried into the atmosphere by wind. The movement of dust-borne pesticides can be minimized by avoiding the use of dust formulations whenever possible and by incorporating pesticides into the soil, either mechanically or by irrigation. Irrigating as soon as possible after the application increases the ability of some materials to adhere. Check the label for recommendations on irrigation practices and incorporation. Avoid applying pesticides under windy conditions. Another potential fate of pesticide residues in the environment is movement into water. The potential for movement is greater for pesticides that have a long persistence rate. Other factors include tendency to absorb to the soil and high water solubility. Persistence is measured by the half-life of the pesticide. This is the period of time that it takes for half of the pesticide to break down in the environment. The longer the half-life, the greater the possibility for movement of the pesticide before it degrades. Adsorption refers to the tendency of pesticides to become attached to soil particles. Lower absorption indicates a greater potential for pesticides to leach or move with water. However, some pesticides that adsorb to soil particles, such as pyrethroid insecticides, can be washed into surface water when soil and sediment erode. The water solubility of a pesticide affects the ease with which it leaches into soil or moves with surface runoff water. Surface water and groundwater contamination can be closely connected, and water-soluble pesticides be a problem in both. Surface water contamination occurs through direct application, usually by accident, or through drift or runoff. It is illegal to spray a body of water unless for control of aquatic organisms, or to drain spray equipment into or near water sources. Use the best management practices to reduce drift as previously discussed. Runoff is one of the most common ways that surface water can become contaminated. It is the movement of water and dissolved or suspended matter from the area of application into surface water or onto neighboring land. It is likely to occur when heavy rainfall or irrigation takes place after an application. The bar graph shows the frequency of detection of various insecticides in water running off residential landscapes in a neighborhood in Orange County, California in 2007 to 2008. Pesticides such as fipronil and bifenthrin were detected almost 100% of the time, often at levels toxic to aquatic invertebrates. There are several ways to prevent runoff. Diligently monitoring and reducing water flow to prevent overflows into the drainage system can minimize runoff. Choose pesticides that are less likely to move or persist in water. If feasible, use buffer strips between the crop and the water source to trap pesticides and sediment. Always have a shutoff device to stop pesticides from being injected into the system when irrigation stops. Groundwater contamination occurs in various ways. Pesticides contaminate groundwater through direct entry and by leaching through soil. Direct entry includes any opening in the soil that allows water, or contaminants in the water, to bypass the soil's natural filtration process, such as plant roots, burrows, abandoned wells, etc. Spilling pesticides while spilling them near a well, pumping water into a pesticide application equipment without using air gaps or backflow prevention devices, and injecting pesticides into an irrigation system without a backflow prevention device can cause groundwater contamination. Leaching is the movement of a pesticide in water downward through the soil. It occurs as rainwater or irrigation water percolates through the soil, carrying water-soluble pesticides with it. Non-point source pollution, as a result of normal applications on a field, orchard, or other wide area over time, occurs when a small amount of pesticide enters groundwater from any location. Point source pollution, due to pesticide mishandling or from improperly constructed disposal sites or holding facilities, would include large quantities of contaminants entering groundwater at small, defined locations. Pesticides that are more mobile in the soil and are resistant to degradation are more likely to be found in groundwater. Shallow water tables beneath treated areas are more susceptible to contamination because pesticides pass through less soil and therefore do not degrade much. There are several management practices to reduce the potential for groundwater contamination by pesticides. Whenever possible, select pesticides that have not been associated with groundwater contamination. Avoid excessive irrigation after an application and prevent irrigation runoff. In sandy soils and locations where groundwater contamination is known to occur, do not apply highly leachable materials. Triple rinse containers, pour rinsate into the spray tank, and use the rinsate to treat a labeled site. Avoid spilling pesticides. If a spill occurs, clean it up immediately and remove contaminated soil. Dispose of contaminated soil as a hazardous waste. Never dump excess pesticides into the soil or into water sources. Use proper methods of handling, storage, mixing, and loading. Store pesticides in enclosed areas on impermeable surfaces. Pesticides may be applied directly to the soil surface, incorporated into the top few inches of soil, or applied through chemigation. Once pesticides are present, that soil acts as a reservoir from which persistent pesticides can move into the bodies of invertebrates, be taken up by plants, pass into air or water, or break down. After contact with the soil, pesticides are influenced by many factors, including adsorption rate, soil texture, the amount of organic matter in the soil, microorganisms, and the presence of water. The soil type influences pesticide persistence and leaching. The tendency for pesticides to be absorbed varies with the amount of clay and organic matter in the soil. The higher the percentage of clay and organic matter in the soil, the greater the number of adsorption sites. Pesticides tend to stay longer in soils with high clay content in organic matter. The amount of water in the soil also affects the persistence of pesticides. When more water is added, the water can release the pesticide from the soil particle and force it into solution. After their release into the environment, pesticides undergo a series of reactions that transform the original compound into various degradation products. The breakdown products of pesticides can be more toxic, less toxic, or equally as toxic as the parent compound. Chemically induced transformations of pesticides occur through hydrolysis, photodegradation, microbial degradation, and oxidation reduction. Hydrolysis is the chemical reaction of a pesticide with water, resulting in smaller, more water-soluble segments. Transformation of many organophosphate and carbamate pesticides occurs through hydrolysis. Photodegradation is a chemical reaction induced by sunlight and only occurs for a few pesticides. Oxidation reduction involves a transfer of electrons and is a chemically or biologically mediated reaction. Microbial degradation of pesticides is most likely to take place when soil conditions support high microbial activity, such as soils that are warm, moist, well aerated, with high levels of organic matter. In conclusion, pesticides released into the environment have many different fates. A pesticide can move through the air and eventually end up in soil or water. Pesticides applied to soil can end up in nearby bodies of water or leach through the soil and into groundwater. Pesticide application in soil or water can also find their way back to the air through volatilization or transport on wind-blown dust particles. It is our job to minimize the impact to the environment through best management practices.